chat, and I'll see that I don't have it shared, but I think I do right now. So once again, thank you all for taking the time to join us tonight. My name is Kelly Coleman. I am the Assistant Director of Recruitment and Public Relations at the Medical School for International Health. And joining me tonight is Beth Chesser, Assistant Director of Admissions and External Affairs at the Medical School for International Health. So we've been doing this webinar series. This is our third part of the series, and it's been very well attended. We've had great feedback and great questions. So we appreciate everyone taking the time to join us tonight. Tonight, we're gonna focus on medical school admissions, particularly admissions case studies. Beth and I spent some time going through some files that we've had in the most recent years. And well, the two cases that we're gonna present to you tonight are fictitious. They really are representative of applicants we see all the time. So with that being said, we're gonna go ahead and talk about two particular applicants and go over what we look at when we get an application like the ones we're gonna present to you. And then we will again, open it up for Q&A at the end. So the first applicant that we're gonna talk about is Arielle. She's a student from the United States, attended a US university. You can see there academic metrics is at the top because that is something we look at very closely. Yes, we take a holistic approach to the admissions process, but medical school is challenging. And academically, we want our students to be able to succeed. It doesn't benefit us and it doesn't benefit the student if they're really not going to be able to handle the academic rigors of medical school. So we look at academic metrics really very robustly. So right here, you can see she has a GPA of a 3.8 out of 4.0, so a very strong GPA, biochemistry major. So right there, I assume, although I will double check, that she has all the prerequisite coursework in terms of biology, chemistry, and physics. And she has a global health minor. So right there, sparks that she's got an interest in global health. Not a requirement of our program, but something that definitely just adds to the application. Yes, we look at that overall number, that 3.8 out of 4.0, but we will also delve deeper a little into her transcripts, looking for things like grade trends and particularly grades in the science courses. And in Arielle's case in particular, I will really take a look at her science coursework given her MCAT score. Her MCAT score is a solid score, but it is below our average MCAT score of a 509. So it is definitely something we will consider an MCAT of a 504. It's not something that's gonna, she's below our range and throw her into a pile that we're not gonna accept her. We will definitely consider a score that's a really a solid score, still a 504. But now what we'll do is look at the MCAT score in the context of how she scored in all the four sections of the MCAT, not just the overall score. We'll see how many times she took the MCAT, were there other scores that she got, did those scores go up? And again, we'll look again at her GPA. 3.8 out of 4.0 is a very solid GPA, and that really tells us how she performed academically over the last 4 years, not just on a given test day. So that is very important to us, and we will look at her science courses in particular. But definitely her academic metrics are solid overall. After academics, we definitely look into everything else the student's been doing for the past 4+ years. Sometimes students are coming right out of undergrad. Arielle will be somebody who's coming right out of undergrad, but it could be a longer period of time for a different student. So Arielle has studied abroad in Copenhagen. Again, not a requirement of MSIH, but it's something we do look at since the student is going to be going to study in Israel. Are they going to be comfortable in a different culture living and studying outside of North America? So that's something that we look at there. The next thing we look at is really how Arielle has been spending her time for the past 4 years. What has she been doing outside of academics? To give us a better snapshot of her, her interests, her passions, her involvement, her volunteer work, her leadership, et cetera. So we look at a whole host of things, the first being campus activities, and you can see she was a peer tutor, whether that was paid or volunteer, it definitely shows us that she works with other students, probably has a strength in a particular subject. As we can see down a little lower, she was a chemistry TA, which leads me to believe she really has a strong grasp of whatever chemistry she was being a TA for. She's been involved in MedLife on campus, which is a global health organization. So there, I would assume, again, that reinforces her interest in global health, something that, again, not required, but tells us a little more about why she might be interested in MSIH. She was also involved in Hillel, club lacrosse, and president of the Pre-Med Society. There's not one particular thing we're looking for in terms of campus activities. We're just looking to see what interests you. What have you been spending your time doing in addition to academics? We then look at her work experience. Ariel was a camp counselor. That's something we see a lot. It's a great thing. It tells us that she works well with other people, probably. She's comfortable leading a group of younger students or younger campers. She's a campus tour guide, which may say something about her interpersonal skills, her presentation skills, things like that. And as I mentioned before, she was a chemistry TA. So there we assume she has a strong grasp of whatever chemistry she was a TA for. Service. Service is something that's very important to us at MSIH. Almost all of our students have a service background, and most of them a pretty substantial service background. What I'd like to point out here is Ariel's service trip was to Appalachia. So she never left North America to do her global health service work. And we always say at MSIH, global health is not just health of people outside of North America. Global health is really the health of everyone all over the world. So people locally, as well as people internationally. So a service trip to Appalachia is great. She worked in an underserved or had a service trip to an underserved area, whether it was international or domestic. That's something that we definitely look very favorable about, and probably something we'll ask her quite a bit about during an interview to see about her experiences, what she took away from those experiences, and so forth. She also has experience as a volunteer on a suicide hotline. So again, service to others, other people in need, and just tells us a little bit more about how she's given back and how she's committed to service work. And then finally, the thing we look for is some shadowing or medical experience. We do not require a set number of shadowing hours or medical experience, but we do want to see that students have done something to further expose themselves to the field of medicine and get a better understanding of what it's like to be a healthcare provider and particularly what it's like to be a physician. It's beneficial for the student to really be sure they want to become a doctor. And it's beneficial for us to understand that they've done their homework. They're all in. They know this is what they want to do. So as you can see here, Ariel was a scribe, which is something we commonly see. And she's done some shadowing in pediatrics and internal medicine as well. So Ariel is really a very solid applicant at MSIH. And I think you can really get a sense of we're not just looking at her GPA. We're not just looking at her MCAT score. We're delving into all the various aspects of our academics, but then we're also delving very deeply into what else she has been doing and what she's interested and passionate about. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Beth Chesser to discuss our other applicant.
Thank you, Kelly, and good evening, everybody. Thank you for joining us this evening. So our first applicant that we reviewed is straight out of school, out of her undergraduate degree, and she, with her biochemistry major, knew pretty early on that she wanted to be a physician. But that's not always the case. And we, in this case study, we're going to meet our fictitious applicant named John Reynolds. Now, John did not go to school in the United States. He went out of the country. He was from Canada. And he did not know when he was completing his undergraduate work that he wanted to be a physician. His metrics, you could see, are a little bit lower. They're not as strong. They're still okay. They're a 3.3, but you know, our average is a 3.5, 3.6. So it's a little bit on the lower side. And he majored in English and Spanish. At this time, he had an interest in world cultures, obviously by these language majors, but he did not show that interest in medicine yet. After graduating, he then decided this perhaps is a path he would like to go. And that's when he came to the United States to complete a post-bac program. He, as you could see here, when he completed his post-bac, he began to improve on his GPA and he raised it up to a 3.4. He then felt he needed to strengthen his application a little bit more. And he traveled to the UK for a master's in public health. Many of our students come to MSIH after completing either post-bac programs or master's degree programs. Now, in John's case, he decided at this point to start he started gaining an interest in the sphere of public health, with where there is a huge overlap with the world of global health. And here he started to say he wanted to mix his medical training, his ultimate medical training, with public health. And there he excelled in his master's program, raising his GPA to a 3.5. Now, John also is not a US citizen, and he did some of his work out of the United States and Canada. We're very comfortable reviewing and we're very familiar with the grading systems in the US and Canada. But John, as per our requirements, submitted a WES transcript to our office for his MPH curriculum. And what WES is a credential evaluation company that will equate his non-US transcript and grade and bring it to the grading system of the equivalents in the US. So he will not be at any detriment by having earned his degree outside the United States. We will be able to compare him properly. And what John also did is when he took his MCAT, he scored very successfully and he got a 512, which is well above our, which is above our 509 average. But we won't just look at it, as Kelly mentioned, we're not going to just look at that straight as an overall. We will look closely into his MCAT, review if this is the only time he took it, the breakout of his scores, and we will want to confirm that he is strong in his pre-med requirements, that that post-bac grade of a 3.4 does reflect his strength in the sciences. But he, as you can see, he's not come that traditional route of being a straight pre-med student in his undergrad, but he obviously developed this interest later, but he has shown, and we'll see through other work that he has done, his interest in other cultures, which is very important and a key element of being an MSIH student. After we've gone through all his academics, we will start looking at some of his campus activities. While he was a student, he began working with those that were less fortunate than himself, and worked in a campus kitchen with food outreach for those for the needy. Perhaps it could have been a soup kitchen, perhaps it could have been Meals on Wheels, but it was somewhere where he realized there were people that were close to home that were not as fortunate as he was. And he slowly began his commitment to service through his choice of activities. But John also has a passion for sports, and he continued that. He continued his sports activities through intramural athletics. He then joined the Outdoors Club, which is great. And he not only joined, but he took an active role as president and showed leadership qualities, not just joining any clubs to fill up his resume. But these were areas where he had a passion, and he was able to integrate that passion into helping others. Once he started getting work experience, he was able to increase his exposure even more to the sciences. As you can see here, John had 4 years of research. He began enjoying research and delving deeper into all the subjects that were now new to him. And this he did it by showing 4 years of research. We were able to see that he did not just do research to check a box off, but spending 4 years researching topics showed that he had a genuine interest in this field and really wanted to learn more. When he decided to do an internship, he turned to the WHO. It's a specialized agency at the United Nations responsible for public health. So again, he is starting to integrate the sciences and service. His experience demonstrated his interest in helping more than his immediate community. He took his knowledge of languages and then used it as a translator. And he used it as a translator at a medical clinic, where he was able to integrate his passion for languages and culture with medicine. His history of service you could see here for a little bit, he went on to service trips to Guatemala, Honduras, but not all our applicants are able to travel far and wide for service. And John was lucky enough to go there, but he also turned to his backyard where he used his passion for languages to work as a volunteer with underserved children with ELS, but English as a second language, for people who had to learn English, and he worked with them. And he continued his work in the food service industry. And as Kelly mentioned, it is after all these steps, it was very important that John understand what it means to be a physician. So to gain that experience, he became an EMT, which is very common amongst our applicants. And he did some shadowing work in the fields that were of interest to him, which were emergency medicine and pulmonology. And he wasn't ready to really decide which route, but to get exposure in all these possible paths. So John also, where his background is obviously very different than the previous applicant, is also a very strong applicant because he has connected all his various interests and activities, shown the academic growth and interest in science and service. Kelly, there we go, thank you. So what you could see by reviewing these two applicants, which were very different, one was a US citizen, was not a US citizen. They came from academic institutions all over the world. But we will examine everything in their application when reviewing them for admission. Some of the items that we look at are listed here. And when we say we take a holistic review, we are looking through all of these items. And you can see through our previous two case studies that they really vary greatly from applicant to applicant. Grade trends. We saw with John on his application, his grade trends continue to grow from his academic studies through graduate school, and which with each step, he improved his performance. Not only do we look at grade trends overall, but we will also look within the institution. Does a student perform better by senior year than their freshman year? Perhaps something occurred, so perhaps they needed an adjustment period. We will look at the grade trends also within the sciences. Perhaps those freshman year bio one, they didn't catch on to the material. By their third year, when they were doing biochem, they were acing it. We will look at both the undergraduate, graduate performance, and we will also look at where did they do their work? What schools did they go to? Each school is more challenging. Some schools are more challenging than others. We know that some schools grade, they have very large curves for their grades, and other schools do not. And we will take that into consideration. We will review the actual transcripts and go through course by course. We will look at the MCATs. We will look at their overall MCATs. Has this applicant taken the MCAT several times and improved over time? Or have they just keep staying at the same point? Perhaps they didn't need to take it more. Perhaps they had a very strong performance the first time they took the exam. And we will look at that breakdown of the MCAT. We will look specifically at their bio grade, their critical analysis, their psych, their chemistry. And we will see, is there a consistency between their MCAT score and their transcript? If there's not a consistency, that might be something we want to dive into further and learn more about this applicant and say, why is there no consistency? Or why does your MCAT not reflect your strong GPA? We won't take it at face value, but we really would like to get more information about it.
Thanks, Beth. As we've been mentioning all along, it's not just the academics that we're looking at. Yes, academics are very important, but we also want to know more about the student, their interests, what they've been doing. So we're really going to look, and I'm going to talk about the next four things together, because I really think that they work very well together in terms of giving us a picture of the student, who they are, what their interests are, et cetera. So as we've mentioned several times, we look at shadowing and medical experience. We want a student to be certain that they want to be a doctor, that they want to go to medical school. And really the only way to do that is for the student to have some experience. And it can be a variety of experience. It can be as a scribe, it can be shadowing hours, it can be as a volunteer, it can be as a translator in a medical clinic, it can be as an EMT. We have several students do Magen David Adom in Israel, but it can be an EMT locally, it can be anything like that. But something that gives the student a much more exposure to the field of medicine and particularly the role of the physician within the healthcare system. When a student is interviewed, they should easily be able to answer why. Why do you want to be a doctor? And it should be based on some of their experiences. So that's why shadowing and medical experience is important to us. Again, not a set number of hours or anything like that, but enough for the student to really be able to answer that question, why. The other things that we look at in terms of giving us a picture of the student and their interests is research. Research is not a requirement, but many of our students have some research experience. Some of it is more basic bench type research. Some of it is public health research. Some of it can be research in a different field like psychology or something like that. But we do see a lot of students with some research experience and they talk about those experiences. Some of our students are published as the primary author or one of the other authors on a paper, and that's great. They've had opportunities to present their research at conferences. So that's something that really, again, tells us about the student and what their interests. And many of our students really show that interest in research through what they've done before coming to medical school. Work experience is important to us too. It can be more basic work experience as you're an undergraduate student, as we mentioned before, tutoring, camp counselor, translator, something like that, or those students who have a job after undergraduate that they do before they come to medical school. We've had students who are nurses before, pharmacists before. They work in the field of finance and then decide they want to go to medical school. So it's a whole host of different work experiences. We're not looking for one thing in particular. It varies substantially, the different types of work experience. The students who are more quote unquote non-traditional coming right out of undergrad, which are about a half of our students don't come right out of undergrad. They've done something else before coming to medical school, usually have more rich work experience, but it's not what we're looking. We're just looking for overall what type of experience you have and how that's led you to the career of medicine and wanting to be a doctor. The final thing, as I mentioned before, that we look at very closely, probably more so than some other medical schools, is volunteer work or service work. Our students work a lot with underserved populations. They have an interest in working with both sufficiently served and underserved populations after graduation from medical school. So we do look at volunteer service work. And I've just scanned through a bunch of applications recently and wanted to give you some ideas of some of the things our students have been doing. We have some who've served in the IDF. We have a lot who've been involved in COVID testing recently. As I mentioned before, some translator services. Some of those are volunteer experiences, tutors, EMTs. We have quite a few students in the past few years who've been involved in hospice as hospice volunteers, and they have a very unique perspective on the medical system and on really a different angle than necessarily treating the patient to make them better, but more of a comforting type experience, helping a patient through their final weeks. So that's really something that I think I've been very impressed with our students who have hospice volunteer work, food bank, working with special needs populations, being involved in art and music therapy. We have a lot of students who are interested in art and music and things like that, and they give back through those interests or hobbies of theirs. And I think that's something we've been very impressed with. As I said before, Magen David Adom in Israel is common. We have students who are returned Peace Corps volunteers. They've spent some time internationally at the Peace Corps. With MSF, with Save a Child's Heart. It's really a whole host of different things that our students have done in terms of volunteer and service work. I remember interviewing an applicant a few years back, and most of his service work was teaching prisoners to read And that was something he was very passionate about and spent a lot of his volunteer time doing. So again, it's not something in particular we're looking for. Do what you're passionate about, but definitely we are looking for students who have done some service work, and a lot of them a substantial amount of service work.
The last couple of bullets here pertain to the actual application process. After all your hard work is done, now you need to submit it to us so that we can learn about it properly. Let's first start with the letters of recommendation. We request three letters of recommendation as a minimum, two of which must be academic of nature. That means this is someone who has seen you in the classroom. Think very hard before you request your letters of recommendation. If your school has a pre-health department and you can get a committee letter, that is preferable. However, not all schools can have pre-health departments where you can get these letters, especially the Canadian schools. Sometimes you're applying and you miss the deadline, and we understand that. So you are welcome to list your referees and have them submit their letters directly to our office. We ask that these letters be on official letterhead of the referee and they come directly to our office or be uploaded something like Interfolio, an independent source. But again, you want someone who has seen you in a classroom. If you're asking a professor who has 350 students and doesn't really know the students in the class, that might be a tough one to get a letter from, even if you've gotten an A in the course. But perhaps for that same course, you worked with the TA very closely and that TA knew you. And that might be a good person to seek a reference from. It helps also, we want to see how you are in your work experience, your volunteer experience. After you have decided and determined who your academic referees are, you're welcome to submit letters from or have them submitted by people who have worked with you. Who was leading you on your mission when you went to work in Guatemala? Who worked with you on Mangaine David Adom? The only thing we do ask is that your letters be written in English, because our committee members, many of them some speak Hebrew, English, and other languages, but we prefer, since it is an English language school, we do prefer that the letters do come in English. While we request three letters, and sometimes it does take more than those three letters to really get an understanding of all your experiences, again, choose wisely. By sending in 12 or 15 letters, that's not necessarily going to help your application, because remember, you're having admissions committee members reviewing your file who are very busy and their time is limited. So you want to make sure that the people that you pick will give the best representation. So as they would say, the bang for the buck, because you don't want to have your third grade teacher there when you can have somebody who's seen you work in your post-bac work. When you choose your academic references, also try to choose someone who has seen you in some of your pre-med coursework, in your sciences and how you've done there. If you were a language major in your undergrad, like our applicant that we highlighted earlier, that would be fine because that was where your passion was. You can include a recommendation from that professor as well. Your essays. We require two separate distinct essays for our application. One is a biographical essay and one is a greatest challenge essay. I suggest you give your essays a lot of thought. Don't write them in one sitting. Write your essays and then come back to them a few days later. Have people review your essays. Have them read them to see if they are able to get what you are trying to say. In your biographical essay, do not spend your time repeating everything that we see on your application. Try to explain your path to medicine. We read hundreds of essays every year. And many of those essays are very, very heartwarming, and you stay glued to the edge of your seat. Not that it needs to be creatively, but it comes from the heart and they're genuine. And we could read that, that comes through your essay. What was your path? When did you decide that you wanted to be a physician? Was there some experience you had? Was it perhaps seeing a physician when you were younger that you admired? Was it a personal experience that you encountered? Perhaps you were ill or treated by a doctor. Whatever it is, tell us about that in your essay so we get a better understanding of who you are. Now, the greatest challenge essay can be a challenge. For some people, it's very easy to say hardships they have overcome or difficult experiences that they've learned valuable lessons from. But I remember one, actually this happened once or twice, where we have received essays that were beautifully written. And the student genuinely says, I've struggled with this essay because I've had a very gifted life and I just can't think of a hardship. And the truth is, this person really hasn't faced many hardships. So for him to have just made up a story would have been very transparent for us. So again, if you write from your heart, that will come through on your essays. And one thing that I must say, proofread, proofread, proofread. After this is all done, make sure you proofread your essays for not only to make sure that it is telling the story that you want to share, but make sure there's no grammatical errors in your essay. Make sure there's no spelling errors in your essay. Sometimes you could be reading to write the word there, T-H-E-R-E, and T-H-E-I-R comes up on your spell check. Catch that before it comes into us. It shows that you review your work very, very closely. After your applications are submitted, they are reviewed by the head of the North American office, who is also a co-chair of our admissions committee, is really your first review. If she has any questions on the application, she does reach out to other members on the committee. And then there is a determination whether we will be inviting in the applicant to interview for admission. All applicants who are matriculating must be interviewed as part of the application process. Our interviews are broken up into three segments where you meet two members of our admissions team, of our admissions committee, as well as sit with myself privately. I'll try to have another person there, so make it a little easier for you to share information. Come prepared for your interviews. When you are invited for interview for medical school, know the school that you are interviewing for. Some schools stress research. Other schools, such as ours, stress service. So when you're talking to people on the committee, understand that if you've had 15 years of research and no service, explain that to us. Know where your school is. Our school is located in Beersheba, Israel, which is a desert. So when a student on an interview says they love to come to our school because they want to sit on the beach, I don't think they did their homework. So know a little bit about the school, what the school stands for, where they're located. If you have the opportunity, we share prior to the interview who you will be interviewing with. Know a little bit about the background of the person you're speaking to. Have your questions ready. We view the interview process as not just an opportunity for us to get to know our applicants better, but an opportunity for our applicants to get to know us better. And it really is important. We are a small school, so it's important that it is a good fit for you and you have as much knowledge of our program going into it before you start. When you are in the interview itself, stay focused. Make sure, even if it's a virtual interview on Zoom, make sure you're looking at your interviewer. Interviewers now are trained and they have experience of talking to people in this virtual world. They can see if you're looking at other items in the room, if you're texting on your phone. Look at your interviewer, stay engaged. It's very important because if you were sitting in a room physically across from a person, you would want that same interpersonal experience. I think what we'd like to do now is open up the floor here.
Yes, Beth, thank you. And I'm just going to comment real quick before we do open up. I have other on the slide as well. And that really can be anything else you want us to know about you. Anything you think will make our decision about whether to interview you, whether to proceed in the application process, anything else that you want us to know about you. I also know some students list on their applications, on their CVs, they list other languages they speak. That's always something good to know. They may list computer skills they have. Again, something good to know. And what I always like to see on somebody's CV is their other interests. I think it's great that somebody has an interest in cooking or an interest in biking or skiing or whatever else it is, reading. It just tells me something else about the applicant, how they're going to, once they get to medical school, perhaps handle their stress because they get stress relief from a run or from spending some time cooking in the kitchen for an hour. So that's also just something on there that it's always good to know about an applicant. Whatever else you're comfortable sharing on your CV is always beneficial. So I just have this slide up here. You don't need to copy any of this down because we will send out our contact information to all of you. The one thing I do want to point out before we open up the floor for questions is the first year blogs on the bottom. Our students blog, our first year students and even early second year students blog, and they blog about everything, life in Israel, classes, campus life, their travels, just about everything, their patient interactions, et cetera, different courses they're taking. So I really think it's a great way for students to see if MSIH is the right fit for you. Other schools might have similar things as well, but I think it's really a good thing to take a look at. So you don't need to copy that down either. You can literally just type in MSIH blogs and they'll come up. But I just wanted to point that out as well. I am going to open up the floor for questions. I'm going to stop sharing my screen right now. You can type your question, you can raise your hand, however you'd like to go about asking a question. Lawrence, I see you have a question.
Hi, so after all of that, if we have not officially submitted our application yet, do you mind if we resubmit some revised materials?
No problem. You're saying you have or you haven't submitted the application?
I think we're pending an MCAT score at this point.
Correct.
I'd like to probably add some things to my CV.
Correct.
So I just wanted to make sure you didn't mind me sending duplicates or.
No problem. I monitor every application that comes in. I know we've corresponded quite a bit, and that's my pleasure. And especially in a case where we will begin, when we start accepting applications, we take whatever you have available. And in a case such as you mentioned, sometimes MCATs are pending. We do not send that file, as I've shared with some of you privately on emails. I will not send a file for review until that MCAT score is received. So you do have an opportunity to add other items or an updated CV or an updated transcript to that file before it gets sent to the admissions committee.
Thank you.
Anybody else with any questions? Again, you can type it in the chat. You can raise your hand. You can just go ahead and ask the question. No current questions. So just to give you all a sense of timing too, every medical school is different in terms of timing of applications. And this is a question Beth and I get asked all the time, when should I submit my application? And what we usually tell students, just, and this again, depending on where you're applying to med school, just something to really keep in mind is you want to submit your application when it's the strongest it can be to be reviewed. So yes, MSIH works on rolling admissions. So we begin accepting applications in July. So we do suggest to students, you may not want to wait till April or May to submit your application, although we have gotten some very good applications that late in the cycle. You do want to be on the earlier half of that admission cycle. But at the same time, there's no need to rush in and submit a score if you think your GPA is going to be better after your first semester, or if you're taking an MCAT, to not say, I'm going to be taking an MCAT, please hold my application until I submit that. So we are very flexible. Beth works very closely with applicants in terms of applicants telling her when they're ready to have their file review and everything is complete and if they want to help before that. But really, there's no rush to submit an application right off the bat. But again, you don't want to wait to the last minute either if possible. Lauren, since you have another question.
So where are we at in the class now? Is it half full, a quarter full? Can you answer that at all?
We don't really discuss our admissions numbers until the very end of the year because it changes a lot during the process. There's a lot, it's a fluid situation, as you can imagine, with students going, exploring, learning. So, I mean, we've been in touch with many students who we know are applying and have been in touch with us and sent in virtually every part of that application except that last piece, and vice versa, people that have not submitted everything and we know they're coming in, and other people just think about it and then decide it's not fit. So it's kind of a it varies from year to year, and when the class fills varies from year to year. We work on a rolling admissions basis, which really will give us that leeway to let the class grow over the course of the application cycle.
Yeah, and it's probably also a little, it would definitely be premature of us to even tell you what the class is at currently. A lot of it is honestly dependent on the calendar too. When we start admissions committee meetings, sometimes we start them earlier in September. This year with all the Jewish holidays, we really didn't start interviewing applicants till almost the beginning of October. So that honestly affects it as well this early on in the cycle.
So another question that came in to me actually today from an applicant privately is about the passport. And I'm running into this actually, it's a very common situation now where students are, one of the items we request on our application is our applicants must hold a current passport from a country that holds diplomatic relations with Israel. Obviously the US, Canada are one of those countries. But what's happened is that the passport renewal process around the world has, because of delays in COVID, staffing, office openings, has really slowed down a lot. So I had a student today who asked me, can I still submit my application? I want to apply this cycle, but I do not have a valid passport. And the answer is yes, you can apply. You would not be able to matriculate prior to receiving that passport that would be current within a valid expiration date, but you can submit everything else. And should there be an offer admission, it would be pending the passport. But here we are in November, and I certainly hope that by July, that person will be able to get their passport in time, even in a slow system. Okay. And I am kind of new to Hero, so the earliest I could apply is third year, right? And now are earlier. Okay. Kelly, you want to take that one?
I'm sorry, I didn't read it, Beth.
Okay, so I'll answer this one then. Okay, no problem. So Sachet, I'm not sure I'm pronouncing that right, is asking when is the earliest to apply? And it's the third year. Well, not really, because we open up our applications the July prior to the year you would be admitted. So for July 2022, this upcoming July, we began accepting applications the summer before. So that would mean if you were currently in your undergraduate program, you would be beginning your fourth year of study. And that is when you would be getting submit your application if you want to attend our school or medical school immediately upon graduation. How that would work with your transcripts is you would have to submit your school sent to us your transcript for all the work that has been completed to date. On the application, there is a place to list the prerequisite courses that are not yet complete, but are either in process or will be complete prior to when you graduate. So at that point, you would then submit an updated transcript, which would show your completion, your successful completion of the program. So you can submit your application prior to graduating, but it would be at the beginning of your fourth year.
Thanks, Beth. I see we have a hand raised. Go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Perfect. Okay, thanks.
I have to say, I definitely started this off with having a lot more questions than I currently have. So thank you for the very informative presentation. So I wanted to ask, in terms of residencies for students who are interested in maybe staying in Israel, do you have a lot of students who place in residencies in Israel? Is that more common? Do you help with that? How does that work?
Good question. And we also had a question come in about residencies in general. So I'm going to answer this and do both questions at once. And Beth, hopefully you can add on at the end as well. So students who attend MSIH really do not need to decide until their third year where they want to do residency. In their third year, they really need to think about obviously what they want to do residency in and also where they want to do residency. And that's important because if they want to stay in Israel, which we do have students who choose to go that path, probably more in the last 3 or 4 years, it's definitely increased the number of students who choose to stay in Israel. Then in the fourth year, they do not have to do their electives back in North America. They can do their clinical work in Israel in the fourth year if they want to. We do have a lot of support for students who want to stay in Israel. Probably out of all the Israeli schools, we encourage it, or really, I should say, support the students who choose to do that. We don't really have a preference where the student wants to do residency, but we definitely provide a lot of support for students who want to stay in Israel. We have an advisor now on faculty at the university who is an MSIH alum who took that path and decided to stay in Israel and do residency there. We have a growing alumni network in Israel. So they really support the students throughout the process of stage, which is the year in between medical school and residency in Israel, and that whole application process and the process of applying to residency. So yes, there's a lot of support for students who choose that path. It's become definitely more popular in the past few years. We had an alum do a program for us, I think, few weeks ago, and he said in his class, 10 students decided to stay in Israel. So that was a pretty big number for us, but it's definitely something that's very doable and there is a lot of support for. Now, on the flip side of that, for students who want to come back to North America for residency, particularly the US or Canada, we have a lot of support for that as well. So we have, obviously, each class has an academic advisor, but then we also have an electives coordinator, both in Israel and in the US, who helps students with the electives process. Students who want to complete residency in the US or Canada are encouraged to do electives in the US and Canada in their fourth year, really July through December of that year. They're required to do 4 clinical rotations. They can do 5. Some of them do that. Probably about half of our students go that path. And in terms of the US, we do have different medical centers that we have partnerships with. Columbia is the big one that we've been affiliated with since inception. So a lot of our students will do some of their clinical work in the fourth year at Columbia, but we do have elective arrangements with other institutions as well. The Mayo Clinic, Mount Sinai, Hofstra, University of Tennessee, et cetera. And then we have, as I mentioned before, the electives coordinator. So a lot of our students will do some of their clinical work in the fourth year based on our arrangements with other schools. But a lot of them also do it based on where they want to do residency or what they want to do residency in. So, for example, we might have a student from Canada who wants to do some of their clinical rotations in Canada, or somebody from California who wants to do some of their clinical rotations in California because that's where they want to do residency. Same thing, specialty. If they're interested in pediatrics, they might want to do a clinical rotation at Rainbow Babies Hospital in Cleveland. So there's a lot of support for students who want to come back to the US and Canada. That is the majority of our students, although it's becoming more popular to stay in Israel as well. Students get advising from both sides of the Atlantic. The director and assistant director of our program both completed residencies here in the US. Well, the director of our North American office is a physician at Columbia, and she did her medical school in Israel. So they really get advising from both sides of the Atlantic. There's a dean at Columbia who does advising for our students. So there's really a lot of support both ways. The US residency match rate last year was 96%. So they do very well coming back to the US, but they also likewise do very well staying in Israel. And the USMLE, which is what students take at the end of the second year, students are very prepared for that exam. We do a lot of things to make sure that they are. That can be used for residency in the US it prepares you for the test that you have to take if you want to go to Canada, and it can be used to stay in Israel for stage and residency there as well. So it's definitely kind of covers all bases there as well. So hopefully that answered the question.
It did, thank you.
No problem. Anybody else, any questions? Hopefully that answered your question as well, Kimberly. Okay, one more hand
raised. Question here, yeah.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I was wondering about the process after residency for finding work for the students, either in the US or in Israel, because I know that the US has some stipulations with if you are trained outside of the US and coming back to work. But I know that this school is affiliated with schools in the United States, like you said, Columbia. But I was wondering, like, what's the support that you have for students who want to come back and work in the US? And what's the support like for students who want to continue to practice in Israel? Is that an option?
So it's definitely an option to, and Beth, you can add on to this, to practice either place. To practice in Israel, you do have to have citizenship. So if you're not a citizen, then you have to make Aliyah and get citizenship to stay and practice there. For people coming back to the US, there's nothing additional that needs to be done. By passing your boards and going into the residency match process, you become a resident in the US. And from there, if you have citizenship, just like anybody else, you can work as a physician within the US after you finish your residency here, with no preference given to where you've gone to medical school. There's no extra thing that needs to be done because you completed your MD degree in Israel to practice in the US. Most of the support for finding a physician after residency or going into a fellowship or anything like that comes mainly from your residency program, not so much the medical school. The medical school supports you in terms of getting your residency, which is kind of the next step in the process, just like, you know, your high school supports you into getting into college, your college supports you getting into medical school, your medical school supports you getting into residency. And from there, the residency program is more the level of support for actually finding a full-time position after. Beth, I don't know if you have anything to add.
I just want to add one point here is the path to residency and then practicing. We prepare our students whether they are going on to residency in the US or in Israel, but the paths after you graduate, MSIH is a little bit different, whereas residency in the US is 4 years. As Kelly mentioned, after graduating MSIH, you go into a lottery, which is for stage, and you're placed in rotations around the country, and then you enter your residency. So it becomes like a four-year residency program, but first you have to do the stage to do that. Now, students who complete residency in the US and then would like to practice in Israel, there's just some paperwork really that needs to be done, and that is all, many of our students do that. But it is much harder, and I don't know that we've had a case where students will then go for residency in Israel and then want to practice in the States. So the reverse is not necessarily the same. But again, in today's environment, I hate to say that that's a steadfast rule because these rules do constantly change. And what is in effect today in 2021 can very well be very different under a different administration and different laws that come into effect. But typically, these people who do their residency in Israel will stay in Israel, whereas the ones who go in residency in the US can do either option.
Okay, I see a question that just came up about a post-bac program or a master's degree if you have a lower undergraduate GPA. And every case is specific in terms of kind of how low is your GPA, what did you do in terms of your sciences. If you have a lower GPA and you've struggled in some of your science coursework and you don't have a very strong MCAT, meaning your MCAT is much higher than our average, but even though your GPA is lower, I do recommend, and I recommend you really talking to an advisor about that. But it may be very beneficial for you to do a post-bac or do a master's program. Likewise, if you've struggled a little academically in undergrad and some of your science courses, it may be beneficial for you before you even take the MCAT to really prepare yourself better by taking some of those post-bac courses or some of those master's level courses. We will look at a graduate GPA just as much as we'll look at as an undergraduate GPA. So a lot of students who have struggled academically in undergrad or may not have the science grades they want in the science courses or haven't taken the science courses that are required do a post-bac or a master's, and it is beneficial in terms of, like I said, preparing you for the MCAT, strengthening your application, and overall really just preparing you for medical school, because the biochemistry that you took in undergrad is only going to get harder in medical school. So really just preparing you for medical school as well by taking some of those courses at a graduate level.
Pleasure.
Steph, do you see the next question?
Can you talk about the cost of school? Okay. So we're very proud of the fact that for the last 4 years, 100% of our student body has received some sort of financial aid. We have awarded scholarship to every student, but having said that, we're not talking about full scholarship. We do not offer full scholarships for our students, but our students are eligible for other loans, such as U.S. federal student loans. Many of our students get MSA loans. Some of our students who are planning to move to Israel get these subsidies that come with making Aliyah at that time, which are quite a few. I don't really want to go into those as well right now, but there are other options. The students do find that what we are able to provide our students has helped them meet the needs to pay their education. We understand that the journey to become a physician is challenging, and we will try to assist as much as possible wherever we can. Keep in mind, our tuition is also $39,500, which is significantly less than most medical schools. And also, the cost of living in Be'er Sheva, where our school is located, is significantly less than any other major city. What I have heard consistently every year is that the average rental of an apartment for our students is $450, which means that our students have to come up with less money. They need to accumulate less money each year to pay their tuition and their cost of living expenses.
Thanks, Beth. I'm going to ask, do you have anything to add, Beth?
No.
Okay. So a question came in as well about somebody who has very solid grades, all the science coursework and things like that, but hasn't had as much time to volunteer or get involved in clubs. And again, what I want to reiterate there is we're not looking for you to fill a whole CV. There's some people who get very involved because they really enjoy it, and that's great. They have maybe more time, other people have different obligations, other people maybe take more time, you really focus on their academics. So we're not looking for you to necessarily fill a CV just to fill a CV. Again, we do want you to be sure you want to be a doctor, so some experience there is always good. And something, to be involved in something, you don't need to be involved in X amount of clubs or have X amount of work experience. If you're predominantly focusing on your studies, that's fine. You should have something else on your CV, not a ton. Again, you don't need a ton, just something on there that you've been involved in, something that you do apart from your studying.
I see here that it's noted that shadowing is illegal. So without being able to shadow, it is hard to see what a physician is doing, but then you can be an EMT and you will get also a feel by that. If you could just, you need to be a little creative and try a different experience that would give you that same understanding.
Yes, and I saw that question as well, Beth, and I know that's coming from somebody in Canada. Just so you know, our program, the previous director of MSIH is a Canadian physician. The doctor who established MSIH is a Canadian physician. We have approximately 20% of our student body coming from Canada. So the Canadian students definitely are not at a disadvantage based on what's allowed in Canada in terms of shadowing and things like that. That's not an issue whatsoever. Our Canadian students come with a whole host of different experiences. We're not requiring anything in particular. So, we have a strong representation from Canada in our class and in our faculty as well. Any other questions? I think that's it. And since we've taken an hour of your time, I am going to wrap it up to now. But as I mentioned before, I will follow up with an email. I'll send a copy of the recording of this webinar out to everybody, and you'll have my contact information as well as Beth. So if you think of anything that you didn't get to ask tonight, definitely feel free to reach out to either of us. We're always willing to help students answer any questions that you may have. So thank you again all for taking the time to join us tonight, and enjoy the rest of your evening.
Have a wonderful evening, everybody.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
Thank you.